Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. And welcome back to Ugly News. This is when I take like little news stories that I couldn't quite make into a full When Beauty Turns Ugly episode. Some of it's new, some of it's a couple months old, but interesting nonetheless, I believe. Let's just get into it. Now, I don't know how many people have heard about this story, but CeraVe at one point were no longer allowed to use the term number one brand recommended by dermatologists because it's everywhere and every dermatologist online is gonna recommend CeraVe. They just do. I honestly don't know one who is against it in any way whatsoever. I mean, let's be honest, this is warranted. Despite my absolute dislike of their products, their brands are good. Their products are good. If someone is really struggling with their skin, I will say, try out CeraVe, simplify your routine, you know, everything that pretty much CeraVe stands for. As much as I dislike them, they deserve the love they get. But I actually wasn't aware of this legal case whatsoever because CeraVe aren't exactly on my radar. And CeraVe has always been known to be backed by dermatologists since their launch in 2005. They've just kind of gone hand in hand. Again, so much so that CeraVe's tagline is number one dermatologist recommended skincare brand. However, back in 2021, it does get newer, I promise, in this story. The National Advertising Division, who in their own words are a self-regulatory established by the advertising industry to help maintain truth and accuracy in national advertising, they had a slight issue with CeraVe using that tagline as absolute fact in their advertising. They basically said, look, CeraVe slash L'Oreal, you need to prove that dermatologists are saying this. You need to prove it. And they did. They played ball. They were very good. CeraVe showed the NAD a survey that asked over 1,500 dermatologists for the brands they recommend to their clients under many skincare product categories. However, after looking at the survey, the NAD weren't impressed. They were like, no, this survey allows for doubling up of answers, doubling up of counting, with people often recommending the same product or products twice. So after looking at this survey, they said it's somewhat misleading. It essentially is a faulty survey. Like this doesn't work out. So the NAD recommended they discontinued using these claims across all their advertising campaigns. And they did. Fair play to CeraVe and L'Oreal. They played by the rules. But just recently, October of this year, the case was reopened. And L'Oreal were like, look, we've redone the survey. Please take another look at it. This time round, only asking 300 dermatologists, but we've redone the survey. The case was reopened, the NAD looked at the survey and they were like, you know what, still not perfect. No survey is, however, but this is an improvement and reasonable enough to use the number one dermatologist recommended skincare brand tagline. Hang on, so they went from doing a survey of 1,500 dermatologists that was kind of shit to doing a new survey of only 300 dermatologists that the NAD were like, still not perfect, but you can have it. Okay, I mean, I guess they played by some advertising rules. L'Oreal, when asked about this investigation, said that they appreciate the NAD's recognition of the modifications made to the survey, and they appreciate basically the case being reopened. They go on to say that they are a strong proponent of the self-regulatory process and thanks the NAD for its careful review of the record in this proceeding. So fair play. They play by the rules. That famous tagline was taken off them, but they got it back again. Listen, even if the survey proves otherwise, or this particular survey of the 300 people that they asked shows that CeraVe maybe isn't the number one dermatologist. I mean, it basically is, right? It pretty much is, you know? Next up, a woman sues over injury by eyelash curler. At first when I saw this, I was like, how's an eyelash curler gonna, you know? Marbella Calderon of Madison County is suing Walmart and Hard Candy of Hollywood for severe eye damage after their Hard X Marilyn Monroe lash shape and curl snapped and struck her in the eye. That sounds absolutely horrifying. Like, I hate anything going near my eyes, let alone something like flicking me in the eye. It sounds horrific. As I mentioned, at first I was like, how much damage can an eyelash curler really cause, right? Like, how much can it do? How much damage can it really do? But what struck her in the eye was the tension bar and spring designed to help the curler open and close. Most eyelash curlers don't have this anymore, probably for this exact reason. But obviously you close it and it springs back open into place. But it's that tension bar that broke and struck her in the eye. So it had force behind it. It had a real springy force behind it. I mean, with all due respect, this is probably the tackiest eyelash curler. It's not nice. Is it? It reminds me of that like Diamante Vaseline tub that Tyra Banks gave to everyone, isn't that? So anyway, the lawsuit states that the device caused severe pain and extensive medical treatment, such as emergency laserectomy, ruptured globe repair, and a lens implantation. All according to the lawsuit. I have no idea what a laserectomy is. I tried to find it on Google, but I found nothing. I mean, that is actual damage. That is full-on surgery. That is real. Because when we do these stories, right, we find that a lot of the lawsuits, it's very premeditative. Like, oh, I didn't know that this product has so-and-so in, and your brand says it's doing something else. So maybe potentially I could have been damaged from it. So I want some money. I want some compensation. Very rarely do we see an actual reaction, an actual physical injury from these lawsuits. But to hear something like this is a real lawsuit. But it gets worse because these surgeries actually had to be delayed because she was in her third trimester of pregnancy. She's already going through a huge change in her life. And now this. The lawsuit claims that Calderon's ability to see and her eye in general are permanently damaged. The 6-count suit is asking for at least $50,000 in each of 6 counts. Calderon is represented by John G. Simon of St. Louis. St. Louis? St. Louis? Is that $300,000 she's asking for? That's probably the wrong maths, but maybe. In all honesty, it sounds like she deserves it. The money, not what happened to her. Give her the money. Next up, a kind of weird story that when I read this, I was like, do I like this? Is this normal? Is this something? Is this cute? Petit Bateau unveils care cologne, especially developed for toddlers. I mean, I think the general idea of cologne is to smell nice, right? I mean, I guess it's cute. Petit Bateau, I'm probably saying that completely wrong, are a French clothing company who have launched a new baby cologne designed to be super gentle for baby skin, with the main focus being on the 97% of natural ingredients that are in the cologne. We know that's not a bonus. We know that's not a good selling point, really. A lot of natural ingredients are naturally irritating. Nature's very good at protecting itself. So the fragrance is said to include notes of tangerine zest, mint, neroli, white amber and musk, which honestly sounds really, really nice to me, minus the mint. That white amber and musk sounds really, really good. The main selling points of this fragrance is it's alcohol-free, composed of 97.5% of natural ingredients, designed to be gentle on a baby's delicate skin, formulated to minimize the risk of allergies. So they're just going to chuck a load of natural ingredients in, including mint. Well done. Well done. Clinical tested, tolerance tested under pediatric supervision. It's also got floral waters in, composed of more than 85% floral waters and fruit water. Vegan formula. I mean, cute. I don't know. I always feel like when it comes to like things that are usually designed for adults, put into like children's form or baby's form, people get a little bit offended by it, like kids' makeup. I compare this to like room sprays or like linen sprays, and you know, when you have a babies, you know, smell, do they? Babies have like a natural smell to them, right? You're like, oh, baby smell, but they also shit themselves a lot, so maybe it's nice to have a spray. I don't know, I don't have kids, and you know what, they're not the first to do this, because back in October, sorry, I don't know if I'm being offensive or not, back in October, Hermes introduced fragrance for children. They say it's delicate and luxurious, with a blend of floral notes like osmanthus and sweet and fresh honeysuckle. Again, sounds cute, sounds appropriate for someone that age. Furthermore, the inclusion of sandalwood as a hint of sophistication and class the scent. Because, you know, rich kids. This mix creates an apricot scent that is both pleasant and comfortable for children. Another alcohol-free formula that's delicate for the skin. I mean, they do look cute. Do we need children's fragrances? I mean, it's nice that things smell nice. Like I said, whether it's linen or people, right? Like, I spritz my dogs with a little something sometimes when I know it doesn't bother them. And I wonder, like, because, you know, dogs obviously have, like, quite, you know, their smells, they like different things, and their noses are quite strong. So you've got to be very, very cautious with how much you use and what you're actually using. And I wonder, is this the same for kids? Like, it sounds nice, but is the interest really in the kids as far as, like smelling it all the time? Because a lot of fragrances can give people headaches and sensitize their skin. And I know the scent's good for delicate skin, and they probably want to avoid a lawsuit, so it probably is, but I don't know. People with children, people with babies, would you spritz your kid with fragrance? Do you do it? I think I would, but I'm also never going to be a parent, so. I also really quickly want to talk about, I'm not going to talk about this at all, but Oxy are back. Do you remember Oxy, the teenage skincare brand? The stuff that used to peel off your skin and rip it and make you go red and make your acne worse, in my personal opinion and experience when I was a teenager. They're back. They've redesigned their products. I'll leave the link below so you can go look at it yourself. But it sounds like they've reformulated and redesigned a lot of their products to make it more current, more up to date. So it'll be interesting to see how Oxy kind of go from here on out. It looks like they're taking the gentler approach. So I'll link that below for you to have a look at yourself. But yeah, check out the whole When Beauty Turns Ugly playlist here. Some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.